In this video session, I am going to discuss about ballistic galvanometer. You all know what is a galvanometer. Galvanometer is an instrument used to measure current. Ballistic galvanometer, this is an instrument which is used to measure quantity of charge flowing through it. So, difference between galvanometer and ballistic galvanometer is galvanometer measures the current, ballistic galvanometer measures the charge. The principle on which this galvanometer works is, if you consider a current carrying coil placed in between external magnetic field, it experiences a torque. The torque tries to rotate the coil. That is one thing. The extent of deflection is directly proportional to current flowing through the coil. Or in other terms, deflection is directly proportional to charge flowing through the coil. So this is the principle of ballistic galvanometer. We'll see the construction of ballistic galvanometer. So this ballistic galvanometer, it consists of rectangular coil ABCD, a rectangular coil of thin copper wire wound on a non-metallic frame. This is shown in dotted symbol. Non-metallic frame, several tons, and this is placed between pole pieces of a magnet, shaped magnet, a horseshoe magnet. The frame is fitted over a spiral spring and this coil is suspended by a passport branch strip which is attached to a torsion head. The current flows through this coil, it passes through it several times, then it flows out of the coil. So this is the construction of galvanometer. The shaped magnets, this provides the radial magnetic field. So in this radial magnetic field, whatever may be the position of the coil, whatever may be the position of the coil, the plane of the coil will be always perpendicular to magnetic field B. So that is the purpose of this radial magnetic field. It provides a strong and radial magnetic field. So, we will see the theory of ballistic galvanometer. So, before going to theory, we will recollect some of the things which we will be using in the theory. Basically, we know the current carrying rectangular coil placed between magnetic field, it experiences a torque. The torque experience is given by this expression, IAB, where I is current through the coil, A is area of the coil, that is length into breadth, B is magnetic field strength. If coil has n number of turns, then tau will be equal to n times IAB, that is torque is multiplied by number of turns in the coil. So this torque tries to rotate the coil. So rotational motion comes into picture. So we'll recollect some of the things associated with rotational motion, which is quite analogous to the quantities with linear motion. So we'll make it fast. See, in case of linear and rotational relations, so we have mass, analogous to that we have moment of inertia. Mass is a measure of inertia, moment of inertia is measure of rotational inertia. So in linear quantities we have velocity, here we have angular velocity. This is acceleration, angular acceleration. This is linear momentum is product of mass and velocity. Angular momentum is product of moment of inertia and angular velocity. Force, product of mass and acceleration. Analogous to force, in rotation we have torque. Torque is product of moment of inertia and angular acceleration. And we have relation between momentum and force. Rate of change of momentum is force. Similarly, rate of change of angular momentum is torque. So we'll make use of these relations. And work done, you people know, work done is, it is product of force and displacement. Total amount of work done, it is integration of force into displacement. So similarly, in rotational case, work done is quite analogous. Force, instead of force we have torque, instead of displacement we have angular displacement. So this is integration of torque and angular displacement. When it comes to kinetic energy, in linear relation we have half mv square. So in rotational we have half I omega square. Quite simple. Instead of m we have I. Instead of velocity we have angular velocity. And this is about rotational equations. And one more equation we are going to use in the theory is this exponential function. So you know this e power x is 1 plus x, and this is the expression. In case if x is very small, we can neglect the higher order term, we will retain only the first term. This will be making use. Now we will come to the theory of the ballistic gallery. Say if a steady current is passed through this coil, if you pass a steady current, there will be a torque and the coil rotates and there will be a steady deflection. The theta, the angle of the deflection would be constant. But instead if you pass a pulse of current, a momentary current is passed through this coil, then this momentary current or the current pulse, it provides an impulse for the coil. It's something like you are disturbing this coil starts oscillating or it swings above the axis passing through its suspension. So this is the difference. If we pass a momentary current, it provides an impulse that sets this coil into oscillations about the axis passing through the suspension. So that suspension, oscillation is because of the torque. So torque acting on this coil is given by the relation. So we just now we saw in the previous relation, torque is given by number of turns in the coil, area of the coil, magnetic field strength B, and current through the coil. So this is the expression for torque. So this provides the impulse. So then this is set into rotational motion. We will try to find out the angular momentum of this coil because of this impulse. So angular momentum, this is given by L is equal to I into omega, where I is moment of inertia, omega is angular velocity of the coil. And one more relation we can use to find out angular momentum. So we know that dl by dt, rate of change of angular momentum, is torque. From this relation, dl is equal to tau into dt. Therefore, l is equal to integration of dl. So in the momentary current passes through time t. So dl is equal to integration of 0 to t tau into dt. So if you integrate this, tau is NAVI dt. You simplify this. So we know I is rate of flow of charges, rate of change of charge. Therefore, we have this relation. So here, number of turns constant, area of the coil is constant, magnetic field strength is constant. Therefore, we integrate it over dq. So here, the limits changes from this relation to this relation. Limit changes. So here it is 0 to t for current. So here, during that time, the charge flow is from 0 to q. So there is change in limit. So if you integrate this, we will get this relation. So angular momentum is given by NABQ. So that we have two relations for angular momentum. From 1 and 2, we have I omega is equal to NABQ. Now, when the coil is rotating, so because of rotation, there is motion, it will have kinetic energy. This kinetic energy, this is used to rotate the coil through an angle theta. Or this kinetic energy is used to do the work in rotating the coil. Now we can relate this work done and kinetic energy. So kinetic energy of the coil is equal to work done in rotating the coil. So kinetic energy in rotational motion, we have kinetic energy is equal to half I omega square, where I is moment of inertia, omega is angular velocity. We have seen this relation. And work done can be calculated using the relation. So this work done is equal to integration of, this is torque into angular displacement theta. So here C is couple per unit twist and theta is angle of rotation of the coil. So just see, this is couple per unit twist. This is not torque. Couple per unit twist into this angle. This is torque. So this is torque into d theta. Now if we integrate this, this couple per unit twist, this is constant for the suspension system. So c is taken outside the integration. We'll integrate for theta d theta. So we'll get work done is equal to half c theta naught square. So we can equate kinetic energy and work done. Therefore, from these two relations, I'll get I omega square is equal to c theta naught square. When the coil is making oscillation, so because of the impulse, coil will be making oscillations. So we can find out the time period of oscillation. So this time period of oscillation, this is given by t is equal to 2 pi square root of I over c, where I is moment of inertia, c is again couple per unit twist of the suspension system. Now from this relation, we'll simplify it for I. So squaring on both sides, I'll get t square is equal to 4 pi square I over c, or I is equal to t square c over 4 pi square. Now we'll multiply equation 6 and 7. 6 and 7 if I multiply, on LHS I'll get I square omega square, on the RHS we'll have this expression. So further simplifying it, I'll have an expression for I omega. So this is easy, you can simplify it. So I omega is equal to TC theta naught by 2 pi. Now look at the equation 3 and 8. From equation 3 and 8, both are equal to I omega. So we will equate equation 3 and 8. Therefore, MAVQ is equal to TC theta naught by 2 pi. Or simplifying for Q, Q is equal to TC over 2 pi NAV theta naught. Or I can write this as Q is equal to K into theta naught, where K is equal to TC over 2 pi NAV, or Q is directly proportional to theta naught. That's what the ballistic galvanometer, it measures the charge. The amount of charge flowing through the galvanometer is proportional to the deflection. So this ballistic galvanometer, it measures the quantity of charge flowing through this. So from this relation, if you simplify this, this relation Q by theta naught is equal to K, which is constant for a given galvanometer, so which is equal to time period of oscillation, couple per unit twist, 2 pi is a constant, number of turns of the coil is constant, area of the coil is constant, and magnetic flux density or magnetic field strength, that is also constant. So this is called as charge sensitivity of the galvanometer. So this is about construction and working of ballistic galvanometer.